Thank you to the AIOC, Dr. Grover and Dr. Murthy for including me in this presentation. My name is Abraad Shom. I practice in Mumbai. And I do not have any financial interests in the materials and methods of this presentation. I will be speaking on two important topics, blepharospasm and ocular myasthenia. And both of these conditions, in my opinion, should be treated by ophthalmologists / oculoplastic surgeons primarily with assistance from other specialties when required. Okay, can I play the video? So this is a video of a patient with a hemifacial spasm, left-sided hemifacial spasm. And though it's not exactly the same entity as a blepharospasm, it is definitely an eyelid twitching. And so from that perspective, we are going ahead and trying to see how we can help this particular patient. So sorry, we don't have the video, we don't have his voice over, but basically what he's saying is whenever he's trying to speak, at that point in time, the left eye closes even more. These patients need help because when both your eyes are closing, functionally you're blind. In this case, it's only one eye, but in blepharospasm, it would be both eyes, sometimes asymmetric. And then what happens is that after you've gone ahead and sometimes these patients can also fall when they're trying to walk, etc. This patient has been treated with with Botox, and you can see he's doing well. He blinks normally. He has no eyelid ptosis, and he can lead a normal life. We also go ahead and treat the levator alecnasi in order to try and correct the drooping of the mouth along with the depressa anguli oris, and I will demonstrate those points of injection, especially if you have a patient with hemifacial spasm. In general, these are the points of injection. About 25 units is what we inject on each side. And if as long as you stay as close to the lash line as possible, which is pre-tarsal and not pre-septal, you will not cause a ptosis. So from that perspective, I know that the textbooks go ahead and say that we need to stay away from the central part of the lid. But even if you go to the central part of the lid, and I would sometimes add a fifth point here right at the center of the lid, as long as you stay as close to the lash line as possible, you will not cause ptosis. That's an important thing to remember. Also, the inferior injection here needs to be as close to the lash line as possible. What we also do in hemifacial spasm is we inject 2 units out here, right at the levator labii superioris alecnasi, and then 2 units right here at the depressor anguli oris, and that does a great job in trying to make the mouth straight and also remove the twitching of the mouth which patients have. This also helps in patients who have Meek syndrome, and then you can go ahead and treat the orofacial dystonia as well. The differential diagnosis for a blepharospasm could be a lot of, it's extensive and exhaustive, but in general we should think of surface causes which are causing reflex tearing and reflex twitching, and those are important things to look at, and that's a major part. Eyelid myokymia can be a very irritating sort of a fascicular contraction of the orbicularis oculi, and at that point in time some of these patients may remain and continue to have eyelid myokymia. Interestingly enough, I have had a patient who's had eyelid myokymia for the past 9 years. Just one fasciculation which he's developed in the lower eyelid, but this has never gone on and developed full-blown eyelid blepharospasm. Hemifacial spasm is mostly on the left-hand side, is unilateral, as I said, and the others are self-explanatory, and which is why I keep saying that a good ophthalmological examination is what we need instead of what I see often, which is ophthalmologists referring the blepharospasm patient to the neurologist, even for Botox injections, which in my opinion is neither here nor there, because most neurologists are not very good Botox injectors, especially in the eyelid area. So it's paradoxical that I've been asked to talk on diagnostics of blepharospasm, and I'm going ahead and saying that there are really no laboratory studies which are required. It's a clinical diagnosis and no imaging study as such. You might want to perform an MRI of the posterior cranial fossa sometimes for a hemifacial spasm if there are associated symptoms of neurological involvement, but by and large these are mainly clinical diagnosis which ends up occurring. Moving on to myasthenia gravis, this is a patient of ours with myasthenia gravis. and this is ocular myasthenia, and he will give you a history of diurnal variation, he'll give you a history of the eyelid varying from time to time, and you can see as you keep on talking and you keep on taking the photograph, if you ask him to look up, which is the fatigue test, you will actually see the eyelids dropping over a period of time and the eyes becoming smaller and smaller. Suppose you have, sometimes aponeurotic ptosis also can behave in this manner, and sometimes people who have aponeurotic ptosis, especially at the end of a day, can go ahead and complain about the eyelids becoming smaller at different times of the day. In which case, what I would do is, before I went ahead and operated on them and burnt my fingers, you will go ahead and see them at different times of the day, and that will be a good thing to do. Also, with the addition of WhatsApp and technologies which allow people to record their family members, you can actually ask people or their children to take photographs at different times of the day or even videos, so you can see exactly what you're dealing with, so you're not confused while performing surgery. Obviously, it would be disastrous to operate and perform a ptosis surgery in a patient with ocular myasthenia. Again, the differential diagnosis is extremely exhaustive. I don't think anyone can even read this. And if you can read this, proves you don't have presbyopia. But I don't think you need to think of all of these things, provided you've gone ahead and done some of the things which are required, as I'm going to talk about. So the history of diurnal variation is very important. Fatigue test is very, very specific. Many neurologists don't believe in the ICE test, but the ICE test is very sensitive as well as specific, especially for ocular myasthenia, and I recommend that you perform it. And if your neurologist whom you're working with does not believe in it, I suggest you have a conversation with them to make them understand that ocular myasthenia is different from full-blown myasthenia gravis. Neostigmine test is something we perform very regularly whenever we are in doubt. It could be neostigmine, it could be pyridostigmine. It is generally performed with an anesthetist around. It does not need ICU monitoring, but the anesthetist should be there for injecting the neostigmine, and your job is basically to go ahead and evaluate the eyelid. And what you should be doing at that point in time is telling the patient that there will be some dryness of the mouth especially and some irritation in the abdomen. Anti-acetylcholine receptor antibodies and single fiber EMGs are rarely required, if at all. But these are important things to know for completion. So in summary, I'd like to say these are mostly clinical diagnoses. Please remember, we are the primary physicians. We do diagnose these better and treat these better than the neurologists. And serology and imaging are at best supportive in these cases. And I would see the patient at different times of the day if required to make a diagnosis. A stitch in time ultimately saves 9. Thank you for your kind attention and patience.